It's good that we can all be here this morning. Hopefully we've all come together for the same reason and purpose, and that is to worship our God who is in heaven. We have a few visitors with us this morning. We want you to know that we appreciate your presence very much. Encourage you to open up your Bibles and follow along with us now as we study a portion of his word. You know, we've probably all attended performances, and at certain times throughout the show, sometimes the lights will fade, spotlight, or other lights. I remember once when I visited Mammoth Cave, and whenever you visit one of those caves, they ask you the question, do you want to know how dark it is? And then they turn out the lights. In that instance, it wasn't fading, it was just automatically the lights were out. I can remember as a boy when I was a young teenager in high school, that after you wore your blue jeans for a period of time, they get faded out. And sometimes you get a few holes in them. Back then, if you had holes in your blue jeans, you threw them away. But now people pay quite a bit of money to buy faded jeans with holes in them. Sometimes those cost more than the regular jeans. So I think all of us kind of get the idea of the thought and the concept of things that fade. And for the few minutes we have this morning, I want us to look at the idea of fading faith. In other words, a faith that just doesn't completely leave us, but gradually begins to decline and fade away as we grow older. You know, when we think of faith, we think of many things. One of the words that comes to my mind is confidence. Faith gives us confidence to boldly move forward. And sometimes as children of God, we lose that confidence, especially when we're bombarded by people in our world and society that tell us there is no God, that the Bible did not really come from God or heaven, but simply is the product of some men who came together and wrote this. There are others that tell us that, well, there's no heaven, there's no hell, there is no life after death, and when you are bombarded with that, sometimes we become disheartened and discouraged, and our faith will grow a little bit weaker. Or if we are subjected to a lot of tragedy in our life, we lose loved ones, we're disappointed. Maybe we don't get into that college or school that we wanted to. Maybe we don't get that promotion at work that we were really hoping to get. Or maybe you go to the doctor and you don't get a very good news report, and perhaps you got cancer or some other kind of ailment or illness that now you're going to have to cope with. And sometimes that can really be challenging to our faith. But we need to understand that when those things happen to us, that's when we need God the most. One thing I've never really understand from almost 45 years of preaching is that sometimes individuals, when they start having all these problems, they fade away and drift away from God rather than getting closer. And that happens with a lot of people. And I think probably because when bad things happen to us, what do? Well, we blame God. God, if you really loved me, if I was one of your children, you'd make everything just wonderful and dandy. I wouldn't have any problems at all. Some people think they have that kind of a bargain that they made with God. Okay, I'll serve you, but I want an easy life. I want everything to work out. I never want to get sick. I always want to have plenty of money. I always want to be happy. Well, that God has never made a bargain like that. We don't read that anywhere throughout the Old and New Testament. He'll be by our side. He'll help us to be able to cope with the difficulties of life, but that doesn't mean that he's just going to smooth out our pathways and make it easy for us. I wanted to share with you a few statistics before we get into the lesson, and I thought this graph may be a little bit confusing, but 4 in 10 U.S. adults consider religion very important in their life. Now, back in 07, about 56% of Americans thought that. Now, when we say very important, we're meaning more than just attending services a couple times a year, a few times a year, but somebody who really takes it seriously. But now we can see that in this graph, it goes to 2021, that's dropped by 15%, 41%, only 41%. And that number just seems to be declining with each passing year. Whenever there are surveys, questions that are asked of people about their religious affiliation, their association with groups, they'll, you know, are you Are you Catholic? Are you Protestant? Or are you evangelical? There's all kinds of things, but they also include a little box that says nuns, which means you're not anything. And we can see that currently about 3 in 10 U.S. adults, or 29%, are religious nuns who describe themselves as atheists, agnostics, or nothing in particular when asked about their religious identity. That number is also increasing with each passing year and in each decade. So we see that this category of people is growing. It's a growing 10. You know, Christians now outnumber religious nuns by a ratio of a little more than 2 to 1. In 2007, when the center began asking its current question about religious identity, Christians outnumbered nuns by almost 5 to 1. So these are depressing facts, but what, as far as our own country is concerned, we see that people are now beginning to place a little distance between them and formal religion and God. People think, well, I no longer believe in God, I don't need God, I'm going to head off in my own way. And I think that if we were to evaluate and look at our country today, we can see some distressing things that are beginning to take place and occur, and that it doesn't bode well for us in the future if we continue this pathway. As we look at the idea of faith, and I want us to just look at a few passages of scriptures that can shed some light. The Bible provides its own definition of faith. Faith comes from hearing and through the hearing of the word of Christ in Romans 10 and verse 17. Earlier in our Sunday morning adult Bible study class, we spent quite a bit of time at looking at some of the conversions in the book of Acts. We looked at Philip and the eunuch, and we see that Philip explained to eunuch the gospel. He preached Jesus to him. And after hearing the word of Christ, after hearing about the gospel, the eunuch wanted to do something about it. They came to a body of water, and he said, here's water. What prevents me from being baptized? And then Philip told him, if he believed with all of his heart, he could do that. So we see we have to hear, we have to be taught the word, or we have to go to the scriptures and read them. We need to remember, as is pointed out for us in Hebrews 11 and verse 6, it's impossible to please God without faith. There's no way you're just going to accidentally make it into heaven. It's not going to be an accident. We need to understand that we cannot possibly please God without it. Now, I've heard a lot of people say, well, God loves us all. God loves everybody. And granted, God loves the world. I think God loves us, but he is not going to tolerate disobedience, ungodliness, unrighteousness. He's not going to tolerate that. The main thing is he may love all of us, but he's not pleased. You know, sometimes that's the way it is when we're parents, especially when your children reach adolescence. We love our children, but we may not always be pleased with them because of some of their actions and some of the choices that they make in life. We don't condone those actions. We don't try to enable them to continue on. Through love, we try to teach and instruct them. Sometimes maybe we have to employ a little bit of tough love and discipline. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17, Paul shares this very important concept that we're to walk by faith and not by sight. We're going to look at this point a little bit further on in another point. He who has believed and baptized shall be saved. Mark 16, verse 16. As we said earlier, as Hebrews 11, 6, you can't please God without faith. We need faith. But we have to have a kind of a faith that is obedient. Some people say, well, I could be pleasing to God if I say, yeah, God's up there somewhere, and then we just kind of live our life the way that we want to. No, we have to be obedient. We need an active faith. And then we can see in James 2 and verse 26, so also faith apart from works is dead. So we need to work. That's important. Although we do point out the fact that we can't be saved without the grace of God, without the gospel of Jesus Christ, we cannot do it by ourselves. None of us can hope to ever earn heaven. We find ourselves in heaven, we can't say, well, I worked and I earned my way here. Well, we may have worked, we may have been obedient, but we needed a lot of help from the Lord to do it. For we walk by faith and not by sight, as we mentioned a moment ago in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7. And we can see that sometimes we get confused with that, don't we? So often we're overwhelmed and bombarded by the things that we see, the hardships that we have. And it's hard to get past that and to see the reality. And you know what? We're in some pretty interesting company. As we look at some of the names of the Bible, Abraham, Moses, Elijah, John the Baptist, Peter, and Thomas, some of these are what we refer to as the great heroes of faith. They are spoken of favorably in Scripture. But in each one of these individuals' cases, we see that there were times when they walked by sight rather than by faith. Sometimes Abraham was frightened and scared, and he told various kings and rulers that his wife Sarah was really his sister. He was walking by sight, not by faith. We see that there were times that Moses, you remember in the very beginning, he was trying to stand up for his brethren, and then all of a sudden he heard that Pharaoh was out after him, and so he fled Egypt, hid out in the wilderness for 40 years. Until the Lord called him back. Elijah, we look at him as perhaps the greatest of all the prophets of the Old Testament. And we see him in some powerful moments when he thundered at the priests of Baal and humiliated them. But then when Queen Jezebel sent troops and soldiers after him, he fled, retreated, and basically told God, "God, I'm ready to die. I've had enough of this." Elijah was operating by sight, not by faith. John the Baptist, we see him, one, crying out in the wilderness. We see that he stood up to the Jews. We see that in many occasions and criticized them because of their misconceptions of faith. And then we see that eventually he's imprisoned. And he sends some of his disciples to Jesus to determine whether or not Jesus is really the Son of God. He began to have some doubts. Even though earlier on at the baptism of Jesus, he acknowledged Jesus as being that person. But we see that for that moment, he was walking by sight and not by faith. He was in prison. He was wanting some reassurances. Peter. You know, we know that when Jesus was taken into custody, middle of the night, there's a court, and three times Peter is asked if he knows Jesus or if he's one of his friends, and he said no. He lied about it. He is walking by sight and not by faith. And the passage of Scripture was read for us earlier. When he began to walk on the water, he saw Jesus doing that and said, "Lord, can I come meet you?" And Jesus said, "Yeah, come." And he's walking and he's doing okay, man. He's walking on that water. That's not normal for us to do. But he was doing it. But then all of a sudden he thought, wait a minute, there's storms, there's waves. He took his eye off Jesus. What happened? He began to sink. I could have entitled this sermon that, sinking faith, fading faith. That's what happened to Peter. And then Thomas, remember him? He didn't see Jesus with the other apostles when he appeared after his death. And the other apostles were excitingly telling Thomas all about this, and he said, "I will not believe till I see him. Until I see the whole imprint in his hand and his side, I won't believe." He's walking by sight and not by faith. That's a human process that we all go through. Even these individuals who accomplished so much in their lives, they had their moments of doubt. And that's why we've got to encourage ourselves to not walk by sight, but rather by faith. Let's look at a few symptoms of fading faith. Well, when you begin to lose interest in worship. Oh, I know tomorrow's Sunday morning and I should be there and worship with my fellow Christians. I just don't feel like it. I had a rough week. I'm a little bit discouraged. I'm a little bit depressed. I'll try to get there next week. When you find yourself beginning to make excuses as to why you can't assemble with the saints, that could be indicative of a fading faith, a sinking faith. That can be an initial sign when we lose interest in prayer. Well, yeah, I can remember when I first became a Christian, you know, I'd set the alarm clock and get up a little bit early just so I could pray to God. If I was driving down the road and got caught in traffic, well, I'd take that opportunity to maybe say a prayer to God. We're looking for opportunities so that we can have that quiet time, that important time with God. But then as we move on through life, that faith begins to deteriorate and fade, and we're no longer praying to God as much as we once were. We lose interest in Bible study. Oh, I know Wednesday night there's a Bible study there, but I've had a tough week, there's a good thing on television tonight I want to watch. I just want to sit back in my recliner and kind of veg out tonight because I got to go to work tomorrow morning, so I'm just going to stay home. The Lord will understand. The Lord will understand. I don't know if he does or not. When we start making feeble excuses, well, I'm too tired, or I don't feel good, or there's something better to do, that's when we are having fading faith, losing interest in being with other Christians. I've actually heard people say, well, I don't like being with Christians because, you know, they're boring. It's dull. I got some lively, worldly friends out here. We get together, we have a good time. I've heard people say that. Perhaps when that happens, you're having a fading faith. You lose interest in congregational involvement. You don't want to get involved. Sometimes announcements are made, well, we need some help with this or that, and people, they kind of, you know, shrink down in their seat. I hope nobody notices me. I don't want to volunteer. I hope nobody calls on me to help out. I just got too much going on. I'm too busy. I can't get involved. We start losing interest in spiritual things because we're so focused on our worldly concerns and obligations. As we've already pointed out, we look at some of the causes for fading faith, daunting circumstances. Sometimes life can get tough. It really can. It can get tough. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7, we've already read that we are to walk by faith and not by sight. Psalm 9:9, the Lord also will be a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in the times of trouble. When we find ourselves in trouble, one of the very first things that we should do is to take it to God and ask him for help and assistance. Perhaps we need to open up our Bibles and begin to read some of those passages of scriptures that may be relative and can provide us with comfort and solace during these difficult times. Psalm 22:11, be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. You ever been in trouble in life, and maybe you got a good friend, maybe your spouse, maybe your parent, and you say, stay with me. I need some help. I got to do this thing. It's difficult. Stay with me. And that gives us some reassurance, and then we're able to face whatever we need to face. Well, that's the way it is with God. God, be not far from me, for trouble is near. When we get into trouble, we need to appeal to God for him to be close to us. Sometimes in life we lose our focus. I like this passage of scripture in Hebrews 12, verse 2. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Fixing our eyes on Jesus. You see, that was the mistake Peter made when he was walking on the water. He took his eyes off Jesus. Sometimes we do that. We take our eyes off Jesus. We look around and say, oh, I got all these problems and all these difficulties, and it seems like somebody's always beating on my door, calling me, wanting money or whatever. And it can get to be too much. It can be overwhelming because we take our eyes off Jesus. We lose our focus. Doctrinal deviations. Some people say, well, whatever you believe is fine. Whatever I believe is fine. You're okay, I'm okay, we're all headed to heaven. But that sentiment is not presented anywhere in scriptures. Let's just take, for instance, the gospel message, the plan of salvation. Galatians 1, 6 through 7. Paul says, I'm amazed that you're so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ, for a different gospel, which is really not another, only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. He goes on to say that if he or anyone else preaches another gospel. In other words, they change the gospel, they distort the gospel. He says, let them be accursed. In fact, the word anathema is used, a very strong and harsh word. We need to be careful about changing the gospel simply so that we can be more appealing to more people. We have to follow what we read of in the scriptures. In 2 John in verse 9, anyone who goes too far and does not abide in the teachings of Christ does not have God. The one who abides in the teaching has both the Father and the Son. So often a group of people get together and they'll say, well, we want to do this and we want to do that, and that sounds like a good idea. Let's all vote on it. Yes, we all think that's a really good idea, but there's one thing they overlook. What's God think about it? What's God's view? And we determine that by opening up our Bible. And we'll find it. At least some of the principles that apply. I think by praying to him, we can gain some guidance and direction. He's not going to whisper the answer in our ear, but sometimes he can help us find those things. Back then, there were people that went too far. There were people that said, well, no, there is no resurrection. There, some of the Jews were saying, well, we've lost interest in this Christian movement, so we're going to go back to Judaism. That's what some of the Jewish Christians were doing in Galatians, and that's why Paul was speaking so harshly to them. Sometimes we lower our conviction and our commitment. We draw influence from friends and family. Paul once said, evil companionships corrupt good morals, and sometimes we have a tendency of listening to our friends. We listen to our family members. And perhaps they say a lot of discouragements. They go, oh, you just need to give up on religion. You don't need to go to church. You don't need the Bible. That's just going to place too many hardships on you. Go out there and live life and enjoy life and just focus on your own happiness. That sounds pretty good in the world. People say, you deserve to be happy. That's what the devil wants us to think. I deserve this. I'm entitled to this. I'm entitled to wealth and prosperity and good health. I'm entitled to that. When we begin thinking that way, that's going to take us farther and farther away from God, and it's also going to set us up for a lifetime of disappointment and depression. I think that's why there's so many people having to face and deal with so many emotional issues. Is that sometimes we just don't have the right attitude and outlook on life. We make things harder for ourselves than what we should. In Luke 17, verses 5 through 6, the apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. That's a good question, isn't it? Lord, increase our faith. That wouldn't be a bad thing for us to pray about. God, increase my faith. Help me to be stronger and more convicted. And the Lord said, if you had faith like a mustard seed, you would say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and be planted in the sea, and it would obey. In this little illustration, you see this hand, and that little seed in the middle, that's about the size of a mustard seed. Back then, they got into the ground and got everything, all the ingredients and everything that they needed to grow up into a large tree. Maybe something we could relate to a little bit more would be a small acorn. We've all seen those. Maybe you've collected them. One of those gets in the ground, we know how big oak trees can get. They get huge. Starting off with something small, and that's the way faith is. Faith, when we first become a Christian, it's small, but hopefully as the years go by, our faith doesn't fade, but rather it grows and becomes stronger. That's what we're hoping for. And then when you have a group of people that have this strong faith, then they're going to be able to accomplish some very amazing things together. Great potential for phenomenal growth. In Matthew 14, verses 28 through 32, and that was what was read for us earlier, while walking on the water to meet Jesus, when Peter's faith began to dissolve, he began to sink. And that's a good lesson for us. We begin to look at life and the world, and our faith begins to shrink and fade away. Now let's briefly look at some of the benefits of growing faith. That's what we need. We're to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord, aren't we? Peter once said that. You can heal a broken heart, as we read of in Psalm 34, verse 8. Sometimes our heart is broken. We're disappointed. Sometimes it seems we can get into a period in our lives where it's just one disappointment after another. We lose our job. We don't get that promotion. We struggle with our health. You know, the last 2 years we've been dealing with a pandemic that none of us in our own lives and memories we have any experience with. Someone had told me about some of the things that happened the last 2 years, a few years back, I'd say, oh, that'll never, that sounds like a science fiction novel. You know, they've made a lot of movies about, I think there was one movie called Outbreak. It talked, you know, a virus that gets out and kills a lot of people. Well, that makes that, that's a movie. Well, no, we saw it in reality. We're still experiencing that. There are still people coping with COVID. The last I heard, there's still like 200 or 300 people a day that are dying. And sometimes we say, well, that's a lot better than 3,000 or 4,000. Well, yeah, it's a lot better. The number is a lot lower, unless you're one of those 200 or 300, unless you've got a family member, then you don't care about the number because it impacts you directly. God can help heal a broken heart. Sometimes before we get married and we have relationships and we're dating, and sometimes someone leaves us and we really cared a lot about them, but the relationship just didn't work out. And we have a broken heart. Sometimes people think, well, like, I cannot go onward. I cannot go forward. That's it. My whole life is over. And sometimes people can't get over a broken heart. And then they tragically and sadly decide to end their lives through suicide. That's a real problem in our country and the world today. But God can help heal a broken heart. Overcome confusion. Ever been confused? In 1 Corinthians 14, verse 33, Paul says that God is not an author of confusion. He was talking about spiritual gifts and some of the problems that they were encountering at that time. And a few minutes ago, we were talking about the gift of tongues, and that was one of the spiritual gifts, and that seemed to be one of the premier spiritual gifts. Everyone wanted to be able to speak in the gift of tongues. As we pointed out in our class, that wasn't just unintelligible gibberish, which a lot of people do today and say, well, I'm speaking in tongues. They were languages. And if you don't believe me, simply go to 1 Corinthians 14, and Paul says some things about speaking in tongues. But he says, if people don't know what you're saying, be silent. He says, you need an interpreter. And people today, they want to stand up in the middle of a service and jibber-jabber and say, oh, praise the Lord, I'm speaking in tongues. Paul says, if there's no interpreter, be quiet. You see, it was one of those showy type spiritual gifts. There were several spiritual gifts, but that was what everyone seemed to want. But God's not an author of confusion. Our worship is to be done decently and in an order. Paul also spoke about that in 1 Corinthians 14, I think in verse 30. Something else that we can see, that we're to rise from defeat. In 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 8, Paul talks about some of the difficulties that they encountered, but they didn't give up. They didn't stop. Sometimes we'll sit out with someone and maybe we'll have several lessons and classes and we're preaching and teaching them the gospel and, you know, we're all excited about it and we think, wow, something really positive is going to come from this study, and then all of a sudden you're studying with as well. Person says, I'm not interested anymore. They walk away. And you're devastated by that. You're devastated. You begin questioning yourself, what did I do wrong? If I'd have done this, or if I'd have done that, or if I'd have said more on this, or maybe I should have looked at this topic. Sometimes we need to keep in mind that people just aren't interested. We can take the gospel and bring the gospel to them, but we can't force them to obey it and accept it. All we can do is do our part. Learn from the experience and move on. Don't give up. We can also see that we can overcome failure in Proverbs 24, verse 16. We can find our way through the fog of grief. Though I pass through the shadow of the valley of death, Psalm, the 23rd chapter, passage that we often hear read at funerals. Grief can be all-consuming and overwhelming. Grief is something different and unique for each person. But one thing that we do understand is that eventually we have to move forward. And God can help us with that. He can help heal the heart. If our faith is not fading, but rather growing stronger, then we can cut through the fog of grief so that we can see God's light and the gospel. Well, also setting aside impatience, that's another thing we get. We're an impatient people, especially as Americans. You remember the way you used to make popcorn? You know, you'd get a pot or something, set it on the stove, throw in a little bit of oil, put in some popcorn, and you do that. They used to actually have what they call was popcorn makers. Now we just want a bag and pop it into the microwave. Get a few minutes and boom, there it is. We want things fast. We pull up to a fast food restaurant and say, well, it took me 5 minutes to get my sandwich. I want it right now. I want it in 30 seconds. A lot of people are like that. We're trying to drive. We got a doctor's appointment. We got an appointment at the bank. And then all of a sudden you got some person in front of you that decides they want to drive 20 miles below the speed limit. You get mad and you start blowing your horn and you're weaving out of traffic and trying to pass the person. And then what happens? You get angrier and angrier. Every once in a while we read about somebody got so angry they started shooting out their window. I think I just read about that here recently. I think it was out on I-70. They had an instance where somebody just started shooting. Something happened. We need to discover the right direction. We're not to go our own way, but God's way. If we do that, if we commit to God, He'll guide our steps, make sure we head in the same direction. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13, faith can help us to trample temptation. God's promised to provide us with a means of escape for whatever temptation may be presented to us. That's where we need faith. You know, a lot of times when it comes to temptation, all it really requires of us is to either say no or walk away. That's it. It's pretty simple. Just say no or walk away. We have many examples of that in Scripture. But the temptation means that we have an internal struggle. That there's something within us that says, well, boy, that'd be fun to do that. And maybe we look around and say, well, no, I'll get by with it. Nobody will know. Nobody will find out. Remember that Old Testament passage that says your sin will find you out? A lot of times it's interesting how that often works out. When people thought that no one will ever find out, and yet they do. That's where we need our faith. That before we give into that temptation, we should think, well, what would God want me to do? Will I be disappointing God? Am I going to disappoint a loved one? If I'm unfaithful to my spouse, what are they going to think? How will this impact my children? How will it impact people around me? That's what people of faith begin to think about, taking a few minutes. And they simply say, no, I cannot do this. Just as Joseph said, no, I cannot have any kind of sexual relations with Potiphar's wife, who was pleading with him to do that. He didn't walk away, he ran away. Sometimes we're spiritually exhausted. Come all ye who are heavy laden. Come to my rest, Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30. Jesus says, I'll give you rest. Sometimes we need some rest, don't we? Sometimes we get exhausted in life. That was the reason that Elijah, remember, he was discouraged as he'd been on the run, and he was tired, and he was hungry. He wasn't thinking straight. So the Lord provided him with some nourishment, said, you know, get you some sleep. And after he got a meal and after he rested up a little bit, then God said, okay, it's time to go back to work. Quit feeling sorry for yourself, Elijah. There's work to do. There's other people out there that have not yet given in to Baal. There are still other prophets out there that are faithful and loyal. You don't know everything about the situation. Sometimes that's true with us. We jump to conclusions. Oh, I'm the only one that cares. I'm the only one that's concerned. Well, rarely is that ever the case. There's always other people who have concerns. Finally, as we conclude, do you have a problem with fading faith? I think all of us do from time to time in our lives, but it's important for us to recognize it and then to take action, to do something about it. In Hebrews 6, verses 11 through 12, we can read, "And we desire that each of you show the same diligence so as to realize the full assurance of hope until the end, that you may not be sluggish, but imitators of those who through faith and patience inherit promises." Now, sometimes we read a passage of Scripture like this, we just kind of gloss over things, read it all, and we say, well, that sounds pretty good. But let's look at a few of the key words here. Number one, we need diligence. That means we need to be consistent about our faith. It can't be a hot and cold situation. Well, you know, I'm going to have really strong faith now, but in a month I may not have it. And then maybe 3 months I'll find my faith again. We have to be consistent. We have to be diligent. We have to work at it. That's true with a lot of things in life. If you want to be able to excel in school or in your employment, you have to be diligent. You have to be consistent. You have to persevere. Hope until the end. And a lot of times the reason so many people suffer from depression is because they don't have any hope. They're unable to construct any kind of a hopeful future. All they see is despair and negativity. And that will destroy you. It will destroy you in your life. It can have a paralyzing effect. We need hope. And Christians can have that. There's a lot of hope that is presented to us in the Bible. We need to overcome sluggishness. You know, sometimes we just think, I don't feel like doing anything. I remember, you know, maybe you remember the old TV show that was on in the 70s called The Waltons. A family living through the Depression, had 7 children, mom and dad, grandma and grandpa living together, as many families did back at that time. And they were, you know, they had some young teenage girls, and a lot of times they'd, we're just down and out. We don't feel like doing anything. Maybe they were upset about something. And usually mother or grandma said, well, I got a solution for that. You can go in there and mop the floor, and you can go upstairs and change the beds, get to work. That'll take care of that. You know, sometimes I've heard some young kids sometimes say, I'm bored. You know, I learned very quickly when I was a younger boy, you never just sit around saying, I'm bored, because then your parents will find something for you to do so you won't be bored. We need to look for ways to increase our faith as the apostles asked Jesus, increase our faith. We should ask God for that help, and then we need some patience. Things are just not going to come overnight. As I said earlier, we're a very impatient society. We want everything right now. Young people, they go to college in 4 to 6 years, they graduate and say, okay, now I want to get a job and I want to start at the top. I want to start out as a CEO. I want to be making about $10 million a year. Sometimes that's the way young people think. We've all heard of the expression, pay your dues. You have to start out on the low end. You got to prove yourself. And that takes patience. So people are looking for shortcuts. Shortcuts usually ends up at a dead end in many cases. You don't end up going anywhere. Hopefully these are some things that we can think about and reflect upon. I thank you so much for your kind and courteous attention. We now, as we prepare to sing the invitation song, we extend the invitation to anyone who here is not a Christian. We encourage you to think about that. If you want to become a Christian, come forward, repent of your sins, confess that you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and then we can immerse you in the waters of baptism. And you can then spend the rest of your life as a dedicated, committed Christian, working on increasing your faith. Maybe you're a Christian, you've fallen away. Your faith has been fading. Perhaps you're sinking. You can change that. You can come back and say, okay, I'm going to reestablish myself. God, I need your help. I need your assistance. I know that I've got a problem. I'm going to do something about it. You're subject anyway. Please come forward as we stand.